Okay, we'll do like a pre-credits thing here, okay? Okay.
Are we going to do a pre-credits thing?
Yeah, I'm just going to do a little introduction, then I'll set it up, okay?
You're recording.
Wouldn't this be a pre-credit because you already recorded?
Well, put it out. Only for then, whatever.
This is a pre-credits scene. That has us talking about having a pre-credits scene. There you go.
Yeah,
all right,
okay,
go,
cool. All right, go ahead.
It's nearly 80 years, believe it or not, since Superman and Batman were created and first appeared in DC Comics in America. They've conquered the various different forms of media individually, TV, film, cartoon, radio. But this year marks the first time they will have appeared on film in a live-action film together.
Mm-hmm.
And, boys, aren't we excited?
Ooh, I'm very excited.
This looks like a job for Silver Screen. Cue titles. Okay.
Ta-da!
Okay. Right, okay, well, welcome to Silver Screen with Jamie Bixby.
Call my agent.
Are you still at the Avon, are you? No. Anyway, welcome back to Silver Screen with me, Jamie Bixby. I'm joined once again by the fabulous Chase Johnson Lynch.
Yes, I am so fabulous.
And the marvellous Merv Johnson.
Hey.
Marvellous, marvellous. There we go.
Marvellous.
Guys, okay, so anyway, this week, Batman vs Superman. That was Superman then.
How
are
you doing,
Sue? Okay, so this week, in fact, the end of the week, Batman vs Superman is finally
Finally, Friday, yep, the Friday premiere. But by the time they see this,
yeah,
it probably would have premiered.
Yeah, we can't do much about that, though.
No.
So, guys, I mean, as long-time fans of the genre, comic book readers, and fans of superhero cinema, we can start with you first, Mev. How do you feel, and what are your expectations for the film?
I don't want to use the words like haters and all that stuff because I'm not 17, but there's a lot of, from bizarrely, just people who've just made their minds up already and throw a lot of kind of like, oh, it's going to suck, oh, la la la. It's like not giving it the time of day. But cut a long story short, I'm pleasantly optimistic.
Brilliant.
Hey, you know what? Life's too short, you know.
Enjoy. How about yourself? Where are you with this one there,
Chase? Give me a single. Right. Pleasantly optimistic? This is pleasantly optimistic. I am more than excited. I've been waiting for this for like 2-3 years now? I mean, I will say, you know, I don't listen to detractors, trolls, haters, or anything like that. I don't care that Superman kills Zod at the end of Man of Steel. Spoilers! I don't care. But I am dead up excited about this matchup between Ben Affleck and Henry Cavill, between the dawn of the Justice League given to us by Zack Snyder. Even though I wasn't that pleased by The Watchmen, I feel that I will be pleased by this. So, yeah, all right.
That's what I think of The Watchmen.
What was that? Right,
go back to the fool. So, yeah, but what we were going to talk about, you said that, well,
yeah.
Merv told us that, let's stay on point.
Okay,
talk
yeah,
about
that. Absolutely.
Go.
Yeah. This episode, we're going to go over the various different Batman and Superman movies since, the 1940s. So I think the place to start, I think, would be with the Batman saga of 1943.
No, he wanted to start with Superman.
Whatever comes first, folks.
Okay, Batman 1940.
We should really start with the Superman because his legacy is far more telling in the movies than anything, because without that character there is simply nothing there.
So,
also he came first.
Well, yeah. Superman, in terms of Superman movies, post the Kurt Aylin movie serials, the actual first kind of cinematic feature film would be Superman and the Mole Men. Georgie Reeves himself, yeah.
I think Georgie Reeves is a fantastic Superman. These kind of people kind of look back on it mockingly because it's crude by today's standards, but I think he was brilliant.
He was the Superman that reflected the Superman of the comic books of that era, of that kind of what they call it, the white bread sort of, hey, come on, let's do this, sort of mentality, which was being force-fed into, well, I can't really talk for the UK, but definitely for American audiences at that time. So, I mean, technically the movie was a back, what they call a backdoor pilot for the series. which is huge. I don't think it cannot be underestimated how big a show that was. Mm-hmm. For like, it ran for like 5-6 seasons, but it was absolutely huge.
I think it was 8 seasons.
Yeah.
Did
probably.
You?
I'm not usually the corrector.
but I wasn't there.
Did you? Showing American, I mean, you must have been weaned on it, I'm watching Chicks. Yeah, that eventually.
I literally was weaned on it. It literally dropped like milk out of my TV set. I mean, like, I gotta tell you.
You wanna take that TV set back, Chicks? Sounds like Poltergeist to me. You're gonna end up in the TV
milk
set.
TV.
You're not careful.
Yeah.
Sorry,
so, anyway, yeah, George V. Superman, I mean, classic. I mean, first of all, you gotta remember that George Reeves' version, you know, because he wasn't exactly a bodybuilder, he wasn't exactly a thin person,
burly,
you know, he created,
burly.
Yeah, well, they called the barrel chest, and he created the Silver Age Superman, you know, Kurt Swan's Silver Age Superman, with the whole barrel chest, you know, and that was heroic.
Suck in the guts Superman, as I like to call it.
Yeah, 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 if I put my hands on my hips, I will look thinner.
The shadow physique, yeah.
But, I mean,
oh,
you,
God.
Yeah, either way, is I mean, it was like Johnny Weissmuller as Tarzan.
Yeah.
You know, when he dives out of the window, you know, I mean, you know.
Oh,
was,
that's fantastic, because sometimes his feet don't move the whole way. You know what I mean? So you,
no, he actually
you,
literally dove out the window.
Yeah, he don't have to move. Well, you don't have to.
Well,
it was a studio window.
The movie itself. I mean, it's a kids movie. Let's not dress it up for what it isn't. It's aimed at children primarily.
Mm.
It's okay. It's a little moral tale, really. It's a tale, really, of anything.
Well, I mean, wasn't
what's the word, of tolerance and acceptance?
Yeah, I mean, were the Mormon actual aliens though?
It came from like the center of the
earth.
Yeah, center
of the earth. So
yeah,
it was, but they actually, because the Superman series was always him, like, you know, punching a gangster to sleep kind of thing. You know, he's always chasing down.
He never
bank robbers
out
or anything like that. So the Moment had that idea. It's like Superman
versus
the Moment.
Idea wise, it's larger in scope than what followed in the show itself.
Yeah.
But that, I mean, that's number one. That comes down to budget. But also formula. They want that formula each week because they know the kids will come back. Superman will do this. Saves the day. Good night. Thank you. Good luck. And whatnot. But the movie itself, what is a really little nice touches about it is the fact that the villains in it, the worst kind of characters in it, are regular human beings.
Mm-hmm.
And it's actually in their attitude. Not so much their deeds, but their attitudes.
Yeah.
The Superman kind of like, he challenges and hopefully enlightens, which is a classic age-old story, you know.
Yeah.
And frankly, one we could use today.
I don't think you could talk about that movie without talking about the series, because for me, that was the main impact with the series, and also its first attempt at, you know, which probably at that time was blue screen, but green screen, where, you know, he's standing on a planet and then his feet are cut off, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because it was only probably like just like a paper wall coming down, so it was always, and then he'd lie on
a glass table and the camera would be underneath him, but you'd see his, like, his flap.
He never quite was straight when he flew. He was always
crooked over an angle.
Instead of being like flat, his body being flat like that, it was always and as a kid,
he
always
to his
above
was
me,
up.
And his arms were lower than his, so he kind of flew like that.
Let me
like,
just do push-ups. Let me get the sack, get the sack.
George, hold the belly in.
Sorry.
You know.
Yeah,
well,
exactly.
We can laugh at it. I think his performance was A1. I think his Clark Kent, he was fantastic. He didn't make
George Reeves had a fantastic smile, you know, and I mean, you know, I could say that as a man.
Well, I wouldn't like to say it as a woman.
No. I'm saying that, really kind of like cherubby smile that kids loved and adored and always is like, and even when he was at Clark Kent, that was really my favorite character, was George Reeves as Clark Kent.
Yeah.
You know, because, I mean, that whole, because he would also break the fourth wall.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know if that was like one of the early times that people was doing that, but he also break the fourth wall. Oh, yeah, really? You know, give you that.
It would be like, gee, if only Superman could know how I feel right now. Well, I don't know about that, Lois.
So the Lois didn't say, why were you standing over there? Is there a camera in
there?
Yeah. I've got a bit, you're Superman. But anyway, moving on, from there, I suppose the next sort of iteration would be the Filmation cartoon. Did we get the movie?
I just conscious that we talk about every iteration.
Should we go straight to the Salt Island?
We will go straight to 1978, folks.
Right,
we are fast forwarding.
Okay, now my question, right, I think comic book readers, the two of you, comic book fans, this is the first mega kind of production based on a character that you both love and you both... What was that like? Was it...
Seminal. Absolutely seminal. I was about 9 years old and I have a clear, distinct memory of going to my local Odeon. And they used to have these little marquee signs with the coming soon before we had teaser posters. And they stuck little letterings, tiny little letterings, like place letterings there and whatnot. And I'd go there every week and just look.
You would believe it, man.
And you could see and see what those were. And then one day you'd have this list of like coming soon. And right at the bottom, it said Superman the movie. And I seriously, honestly thought that's it. Life is complete. Life is complete. I do not need to do it. It's the single greatest moment in my entire life, to my 9-year-old life.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I just could. I was counting the seconds. This is the days, but obviously there's no internet, there's nothing like that. So information about the movie was very, very, very sketchy. We knew that it was coming. We knew that it was Marlon Brando was in it. He was the biggest star. You've got to remember.
You cannot
underestimate the fact that he was the biggest movie star in the world.
Yeah.
Okay. Only Clint and Steve McQueen were the only people who were remotely close to him in the kind of big movie star at that time. Yeah. So to have him in this was like.
Can I just say so? I think he was fantastic in the film as well. Other people say he's a paid. I think he had a presence.
He definitely had a presence. I mean, you know, I mean him with the little spit curl. And the fluorescent.
It looked like Jiffy popcorn. Do you know what I mean?
Fresh effect at the time, but he set up a world. Set up a universe. Now let me tell you about my first experience watching.
Yeah.
So you know what I mean now, right? Cool. So my uncle, who was a big Batman fan, who got me into comics, you know, and everything like that, said, "Look, I'm taking you to see this movie." Do you know what I mean?
All right.
What? You know, because usually I had to sneak in, go with my brother and friends or whatever, blah, blah, blah. He's like, "I'm taking you to see this movie." We stood online because, like, Jaws had come out, right? So it was already, people now used to this thing called the blockbuster and everything like that. So they lined up around.
It was like, I'd say the third or fourth of the blockbuster.
And blockbuster as well. It was a Christmas.
So we're online and I'm like, I want to see Superman. And like Murray says, Superman the movie to me is like, you know, just that stream of red and blue.
Yeah.
You know, going to the S.
The logo,
saying,
yeah,
but on the poster saying you believe a man can fly.
Yeah.
Right? So I'm like, oh man, I'm dead excited. Now, movie's crowded, it takes it down. The only seat is in the very front row.
Oh God, no.
Wait. Mm. Only seat is the very front row. So I was like, oh God, no, right? Sitting down. Wait for the movie, got my popcorn, and you know what happens next. After the coming of trashy trailers, it's like, dum, 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 dum.
Yeah.
Dum, 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 dum. And then, what the? You know what I'm saying? It was just like that. It was just like that.
Yeah.
The flying letters, you know, was amazing. It was like, I was totally enthralled from the beginning. Yeah. To the very end of that movie.
That's what people were not expecting. I think when the movie was released, people were expecting some sort of based. Because look, you've got to remember, the only other precedent was Batman.
Yeah.
In that respect. So the idea of like a comic book movie was kind of like comic books. They're silly. They're for kids. Blah 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 blah. This was an epic piece of movie. This was a great. Forget the origins of the comic. This was a great movie.
Mm-hmm.
This was a really kind of like, wow, you know, they've spent millions on it. It looks like they've spent millions on it. Richard Donner's direction is pretty flawless. Its three-act structure is absolutely solid and tight and clear, completely. It goes from there to there to there.
All that without like a super-powered bad guy fight.
Yeah, and that's one thing actually that has always bugged me is about the later movies and even movies to this day when people say, Superman really didn't do much. I like it when he's hitting stuff. No one complains about Superman the movie. In fact, that's still to this day seen as the benchmark for all.
Well, because he turns back time by moving the planet.
I think it's more to do with the fact that the actual movie, to forget what actually happens in it, in terms of who's he fighting, is he doing this, is he not? No, are we captivated by the story?
Yeah,
the two ingredients to anything like that is it's got a solid story that engages us and characters we give a damn about, and which leads me directly to Mr. Reeve himself, who
I thought was George Reeves' son, or the reincarnation, but
Christopher Reeve, both blessing and curse, it was just so good. To me, it's like Connery as Bond. It's just like it's so difficult to wedge it away from that character.
To this day, when I read the Superman comic, I hear his voice. If someone mentions Superman, that's instantly what I think of.
Well, yeah, like even in the Brandon Ralph and the Henry Cavill, you still hear
his ghost. That's probably a bad. You know, it's sort of
spirit.
But I mean, if you could just looking at the cast, there's a question for the toys. How much do you think like the familiarity of the cast, like Hackman and Brando, was key to its success? Or do you think
absolutely, because without those, number one, the movie wouldn't got made. Secondly, it gave the interest beyond kids.
Yeah.
Who would say, "Oh, look, Superman! I know Superman. He's from the comics, he's from the cartoons, etc., etc." Okay, it's going to be like, "Oh, wait a minute, Gene Hackman. What do you mean, Popeye Doyle? Wow, he's in that movie. Glenn Ford's in it. Oh my God, who's great in Network as well. I think it's often for
what a double actress.
But all these actors and whatever, but." So as a whole package, it's a solid, solid movie.
Hey, notice how you didn't say Margot Kidder?
Mm. I didn't say Margot Kidder. My bugbear about Margot Kidder in the role was I hated her scream.
Okay, what's that?
I hate that. Help!
Who got you? You got me? Who got you?
Yeah. Oh, please, Chase, just say Jim, not a bad outfit.
No, don't.
Jim.
No, don't.
Oh my God! You tried to get me to do that. Oh,
go for it.
No, I'm not going for it. Oh, anyway, let me tell you about my favorite moment in the movie.
We'll do that. How's that? Yeah?
Let me tell you about my favorite moment in the movie. Right. So, quintessential moment is when she does the interview with Superman and everything, and she's all like, come back from her flight. And everything, and then Clark comes in. Oh, hey, hello, and she's like, she's still in the daze, she's still in the hypnotic daze, and he takes off the glasses.
Well, yeah,
and he flexes.
It's funny.
Hold on, man, you're killing my moment, right? And then she comes out and goes, oh yeah, those. He looks like two totally different people.
Exactly. Yeah. I've used that. I continue to use that in acting. when I'm teaching acting workshops, I actually use that sequence as one of the about physical performance and characterization, how it is absolutely possible by the slightest nod and a wink and a nod here and there to change your persona to the point where it is unrecognizable from one to the other. That sequence alone should have given Mr. Reeve a nomination that year.
I agree. I think as well, if you look at he sort of shortens himself by like a foot to play Kent.
Superman is a mountain, and Clark is this kind of hamster.
That's right.
That
scene's fantastic. That scene's pointed out now where she says goodbye and he flies off, and then everyone said there must have been a cut there because the camera.
There's no cut.
It's a cinema screen.
I did not learn that until about 15 years ago.
Yeah.
Where they shot Superman waving goodbye and Lois saying goodbye. They shot it though, but they shot it in 70mm, so you get the highest resolution you could possibly could. Because obviously when you composite it back into it, you downgrade it. So you always go for the highest resolution first. Very technical problems. But anyway, cut long story short. Now I always thought there's a cut when she walked across the bushes or something. But no, they just had her stand in front of a screen, wave goodbye.
Yeah.
He walks out, he flies up, she walks along, knock at the door, there's Clark waiting for it, and it's
that's true movie magic, that. It's fantastic.
I mean, nowadays, there you go. It's seven, two.
Yeah. One of the most important things in the film for me is, I'll explain why, is Gene Hackman's Lex Luthor. I think they set him up really nicely in the vein of like the Batman TV series as a villain, but then there's a turning point.
There's a streak.
Yeah.
A streak, and then when he takes out the, like...
Superman says, is this how I walked? Mine gets its kicks by imagining it, and he says no.
And he's walking down a little steps and going, this old, what?
My favourite moment in this, and it is funny, but it's as cold as can be, is when he's told Superman where the two missiles are going, and he says, like, you don't even care where the other one's going, because of course I know exactly where it's going. Hackensack, New Jersey. And he goes, does his little line, and he walks off, and then Miss Tessmacher walks up and says, like, my mother lives in Hackensack, and he just goes, looks at his watch and just goes,
Yeah.
And walks off.
The interplay between them and BT as well. No, that next time I'll just put my robe on when I get out of the pool.
But it did bug me, though. I mean, because you don't, once again, there's no internet. We didn't know anything about what's going to happen. But what did bug me throughout watching this movie was the fact that he had hair. Now, I always assumed when he had different hair, he did have wigs on, but it was covering up his hair.
Yeah.
Blah, 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 blah. So that final sequence, I remember feeling I could rest easy. When he takes the wig off, Lex Luthor is bald, and you think, oh, it really is Lex Luthor. Okay, all sins forgiven. You know, that, and this cannot be said enough, really. The music.
Oh, John Williams.
The music is just...
What
can you say? It's one of my two favourite John Williams scores. The other one being Close Encounters. But
from what I heard from Richard Donner speaking at a convention, Jerry Goldsmith had been working on it,
He wanted Jerry. Jerry wasn't available. John Williams was talked about, but he wasn't available, and then all of a sudden became available. Because he was working on The Fury at the same time.
That's right, yeah.
But he finished that off in time for him to actually do Superman. Superman actually was quite short production schedule for John Williams.
It was also short because it was actually the second attempt at making a movie.
Well, it's about the 17th, I think.
I meant at that time. I mean, you know, where they actually started out.
They did some tests. They did test footage. They didn't really shoot.
Started out with that other actor.
Guy Hamilton.
They never had anyone secured. They never had any actor secured in the role. They screen tested like a trillion people. But Guy Hamilton was attached for a long time, and he did shoot some tests. Well, he didn't shoot. He commissioned test footage for production design and a few effects.
Thankfully, we never will see that footage again. But
back to John Williams' theme, sorry, Chase. I remember Richard Donner said he played them something on the piano. So Richard Donner's memory sounded a lot like the theme from Star Trek The Motion Picture. He said this is what he was going to go with, but Williams comes in and he just blows it out.
Donner tells the tale himself about how he ruined the first take of the main theme by just proclaiming, genius, this is genius, with tears in his eyes. This is actually genius, because he felt, you can hear the name Superman.
It says it, doesn't it?
And it's funny because since then, where Bruce Timm, the animation producer behind the Batman series, animated series, and Superman Justice League and all that stuff, he said that when they did their Superman show, his request to Shirley Williams, who scored at that show, was the theme tune, you should be able to sing the words Superman in it. So, and have you not noticed? And since then, you can actually. I mean, sure, you can shoehorn it in anywhere, but that is so.
What were you going to say, Chase?
So what I was going to say was before we ended this part about Superman, is the emotional depth of the film, you know, and like even though despite, you know, our feelings about Margot Kidder, you know, I do think it was poor casting choice, but the emotional depth is that near-death scene. You know, like where, you know, he's saving the world, he's saving everybody except for the person closest to him. And, you know, when he, like, finally, you know, he goes around, you know, he just looks around and he can hear, you know, that she's dying.
Yeah.
You know, and as he's saving people, the love of his life is dying.
Mm. Yeah.
You know, and the edit of that was just amazing. And then when it comes into the close-up of him, like, realizing, and then he's, like, looking around the world, boop, 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 and then he could spot her in that crater, and then cut right to it's like Stanley Kubrick in 2001.
Yeah.
Cut to him ripping the door off, pulling her out of the car and everything, and then oh my god, I haven't
so
and
treats
her like this.
He treats her so like a porcelain doll. She's so fragile.
I'm talking about Christopher's acting. It's in the neck, right? You know, and this is always what I look for, like, and when you try to do emotional scenes, it's like, he can't catch his breath, it's like, you know, it's like, and he's in his, straining his neck before he screams, and then he's out, and then he turns the planet back. Mm. I'm telling you, that scene, just look at that scene for emotional depth.
Can I just very quickly, I want to tell you my Christopher Reeve story, because if I'm going to tell her anywhere, now is the best place to do it. I was, without getting too much, I was bullied in school, right up to the age of 7, because I had various different problems and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Eventually, I stopped going to school. I couldn't go because I was so frightened. And, you know, doctors and teachers tried to get me to go. Anyway, I was given money for my birthday, and I went to Zodiac, the toy store, that used to be in Liverpool, not there anymore, and with the intention of buying action figures. And my granddad, who was with me, said, Jamie, quick, round it is Superman. So I went round the aisle thinking it was a Superman action figure. It was Christopher Reeve. He was here. He was hosting the John Lennon tribute concert at the Pierhead.
Oh, okay.
And my granddad had spoken to him and told him your problem. So he kneeled down next to me, Christopher Reeve, and he said, now listen, I can remember all those, he said, listen, he said, these people who are hurting you like that, he said, these are the bad guys, you know, like Lex Luthor. He said, you're one of the good guys. He said, and if we stick together, we can beat these people. He said, so will you do that for me? Will you go back to school for me? I got my photograph with him, I got an autograph, and I can show
that's a good story.
It was, for me, Superman in real life, and on cellular as well, and, you know, I still think, you know, like, Superman's greatest, greatest achievement still on because of what we've learned, you know, like, about stem cell regeneration.
Well, yeah, you know, as long as people don't block that in an ironic way, but, So Superman the movie comes out. It's it's the joint biggest hit of 78, through 79, along with Grease.
Yeah.
It's kind of like the bit neck and neck, which is the word, apparently.
Stockard Channing nearly played Lois.
Stockard Channing, she was like that close.
Yeah.
I actually think, no offense to Margaret Kidder, she is a better actress than Margaret Kidder.
Oh, yeah.
But I think that she would have been too good. I think she would have ate Christopher Reeve alive. Her Lois is too. Seeing the screen test and stuff, it's so good. But like I say, it's just too much. There's nowhere on earth that her Lois would have anything to do with him in any shape or form.
Yeah.
But you know, I mean, I like Leslie Ann Warren, Ann Archer. I mean, I'd hate to have been the guy who makes the choice.
Definitely.
You know, I think there.
Ann Archer was. And then she ended up doing Hero at Large, so she would definitely have been the better choice.
Liza Minnelli went for the role. Liza Minnelli went for the role.
But you got to remember, in another universe,
choice.
We got to at least screen test.
Yeah.
For what?
Okay.
For Superman.
Look, he was really fantastic, Rich Man, Poor Man, but there's no way. I mean, like.
But it's once again,
you can imagine.
Donner wanted actors, the producers wanted stars.
Yeah.
And they went through every star, and they all went, nope. Look stupid in tights. No. And to a point. Yeah, I can see that. I can understand that.
Warren Beatty, I don't know if you read that biography where he said he struggled with the decision because he's a big comic book fan. And he was like, but he said in the end he couldn't see himself doing it. He said, so audiences would probably have that same problem.
Mm.
But just before we move, the special effects by Derek Meddings and Colin Chilvers.
The Zoptic effects are the Zoptic effects are the real groundbreaker. Okay, have they aged?
Zero optic effects.
Yeah, but you got to remember, for 78, for an audience, just was like, wow, you know. Well, the only thing I could never quite understand is how come, with the advances in technology, even before digital stuff. The effects in those movies got worse. I'm not jumping ahead to Superman 4 here, but 2 and 3, they're like not as good as the ones in Superman 1. It's time. They had a little bit more time. It wasn't even a case of more or less money at all, because the first two sequels had a hefty budget behind them.
I enjoyed the special effects in Superman 3, but it's what the representative, you know what I mean, rather than just...
I don't know, I mean, but like I say, we'll get to Superman 3 in
Yeah, well, let's go.
We'll jump to Superman 2.
Right. Okay, so we're going to have a look at Batman now. We're going to go that way. So I think the best place to start with Batman would be the 1966
movie. I saw the 1966 movie in the theater, not in 1966.
I saw it in
1966. But like, you know, because the way television was back then, before cable and VCRs and stuff, everything kept constantly being repeated, especially in the cinema, so that way they could regroup their money.
Yeah.
So I can remember going to my local theater on my own to see Batman 66 in the cinema. and stuff. And I mean, it was amazing because you got to see not just one, but four of Batman's villains onto the screen fighting Batman at the same time. So even though as adults we look back at Batman, we laugh, you know, it was so cheap and chintzy and comical, but it still was then, but we didn't have that head about us that,
I've always said the same thing.
So for me, it was great.
Both that movie and the show itself, as a kid, I didn't see any jokes. That movie and that show was as serious as anything Chris Nolan could have come out with years later. I saw the show first, but I saw the movie on the big screen there was a phenomenon in the UK that right up until the late 70s where on Saturday mornings, cinema chains, movie theatre chains would show kids' movies or have cartoons and stuff. Saturday morning pictures. And in which you'd get a couple of cartoons, some competitions done in the plays, and then maybe one like movie. It's usually some sort of old movie that's been out before, Jason. Not even a big movie, but like a... There was a company in the UK called the Children's Film Foundation, which ran from the 70s right through to the early 80s. The 50s right through to the early 80s. And so we'd see movies up by them. But every now and then they'd show us something like a Godzilla movie. I saw those. One day, because I didn't tell you what was coming on. Because you didn't actually know. You didn't know. And it was like, and it just starts. And you just get the words, and you have the old BBFC, when it was the British Board of Film Censors, the old logo, telling us this was a U movie or whatever, a general movie, and it comes on, and Spider-Man, who's Batman? Who's Batman? Because that's how kids talk where I come from. Who's Batman? Batman? More noise being made by kids telling everybody shut up shutting up. But anyway, cut to the job. It starts, the place explodes. Manic. But we all watch it, but we still take it deadly seriously.
But see, what was great was that, like, because the TV series had already been out, like, what happened was that the movie was actually made in between the first and second season. So it didn't have the same credits as the TV show. That was what was amazing about it, because when I saw it in the cinema, I actually thought I was seeing a new movie at first, because it had that really interesting spotlight, kind of like a Dick Tracy kind of thing, you know, where this guy with the, trench coat down the alley. And I mean, it was like amazing. And then, Adam West coming out, and I mean, no, it was great. But, It was just cool. And also, maybe because I was getting a little bit older, I saw it in the 70s, like I said, looked like Batman was going to get busy with
Captain.
I was a kid. I didn't totally comprehend, but I'm kind of like, he's really excited here. What scene I'm talking about, right?
As Jason's already pointed out, it was made between seasons one and two. But I love the fact that the money for the movie came from 20th Century Fox's film division, not the television division. So they actually had a bit more money. But I loved the long-term thinking from their part. If we write in the scripts, we can have a helicopter, we'll have a boat, and then we can just take those things and stick them in the show. And thus saving them a ton of money.
Because we've already made it. So now we can have it for season
What's interesting
three.
Is it was a hit. The movie was a hit.
That's right.
But here's the thing. I mean, the show and that movie is kind of, dismissed as kind of camp and silly. But I'll tell you one thing, it definitely is. And it's smart. Its humour is really on the button. They know exactly what they were doing. They never were. It wasn't just dumb fun. It was.
Well, except for just the days you can't get rid of a bomb.
That's witty though. But that's smart writing. It really.
It was kind of clever.
Bedroom, I've got a 2 foot statue of Adam West. That really
with the bomb.
Yeah. I love the 60s Batman series, but people seem to think you can only like. One or the other. Do you like the dark or do you like?
I like it. It's Batman. But Batman, like Tarzan or Sherlock Holmes or something, the character itself is so resilient. No matter what era, no matter what kind of body it takes, it survives it. It's bigger than the
really truly damage it. I think it's like. It's synonymous for me with childhood, so it's as much an experience as nostalgically as like as sweets and you know that kind of thing. It's like a bag of jelly beans to me, that kind of thing. So we could go back now, dip back into Superman. Superman 2,
which was shot at the same time as Superman 1.
Yeah, back to
back. If there weren't that else, it wasn't back shot back to back. And this is what shot simultaneously. I think people tend to get the two mixed up. I mean, you know, yes, you can shoot back to back. I mean, things like Back to the Future 2 and 3 were shot. Yeah. Basically, it was one long shoot. You finish on the Friday on 2, you go straight to 3 on the Monday.
It was kind of like a Zack Snyder shoot.
But these were shot at the same time. So, like, you'd have the Daily Planet set was there, you'd shoot couple of scenes from 1, you shoot a couple of scenes from 2, blah 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 blah, and then of course towards the end of Superman, the making of Superman movie, it all goes to hell.
But that's what I mean, is that because it was shot at the same time, like you said, one long shoot, it's like you gotta think that when we saw the three prisoners, like Zod and Ursa, in that scene, you know, it wasn't like a couple of years later, let's go back to them. It was like, okay, well, next week or, you know, a couple of weeks, we're going to shoot you, you know, breaking out and coming to. Yeah. So that was the whole conversation with that. But as Merv said about going to hell, is that the Zolkins, for some reason, wasn't liking what Donner was doing.
Well, he got credit for the film that they wanted. But
well, essentially, it comes down to that. Okay, the Elias Zolkin comes up with the idea we should make a Superman movie. But as a producer, he forgot that golden rule. The producer's role is to get the film made.
Yeah.
The director's role is to make the film.
Yeah, you know, kind of like
and it's like, oh, hold on a minute, was it success as many fathers, failures an orphan, but it's kind of like, you know, they don't like what he's doing because he's making a Richard Donner movie. We've hired Richard Donner and he has the gall to make a Richard Donner movie.
Yeah,
you know, bit of ego, bit of money, you know, bit of power.
Yeah,
it goes a long way, whatever. But it's a real shame. What's interesting actually is the fact that the original proposed ending for Superman, the first movie, was quite.
The ending for Superman 2 or
no, Superman 1? Superman, the original ending of Superman 1 was kind of really just Superman coming in and saving the day and then getting to Lois just in the nick of time. And like, ooh, And of course, we've already shot, you know, we've thrown the rocket into space and it would end on the cliffhanger of the Phantom Zone cracking and the three villains escaping. And that would have been like, come back for next episode next year. You know, because we, you know, all things being equal, had Donner been allowed to complete it properly, we would have had Superman in 78 and Superman 2 in 79. Mm-hmm. Hence, it does state that the original prints on Superman movies does state next year Superman 2. We didn't actually get it until a couple of years later. No. But what's really, that is a kind of a flat ending, as originally proposed. So they took that ending from the proposed ending from Superman 2, of him spinning the world around to make Lois forget.
Yeah.
About the fact that he's become.
Can I just say
he has spin the world around? You talking about when he kisses her?
No, that was supposed to be the end of Superman 2.
The original ending, if you watch the Donner cut of Superman 2, the Donner cut, which is a kind of.
I have seen the Donner
cut. Can I just say, the single greatest influence on me as a director is Richard Lester, and I know I'm going to get shot. Like, I like Richard Lester's version because it's the one that I grew up with and stuff. But.
Well, you could say that.
But what is his version? You gotta see. This is where you get into really difficult territory, especially when you're talking about directing. Is that Richard Donner directed both films? But what had happened was because, as Merv said, because everything got all sticky and he got like go and brought it. Like, what was Lester? Was he the editor or?
No, Lester was for that movie. He was brought in as associate producer. And the reason he was actually involved in the first place is because Zolkins owed him a lot of money.
Yeah.
A lot of money. And a cut long story short, he had shot the Three Musketeers. Unbeknownst to him and a lot of the actors, that this supposedly 3-hour movie got cut into two-hour movies without pretty much everyone's permission. And then you end up with the Three Musketeers and the Four Musketeers. It was supposed to be this giant 3-hour epic of both. I'm a big fan of both those movies. I love them both. But the fact of the matter is, they owed Lester.
Yeah. So that happened before this movie, then, right?
Yeah.
So that means that they were used to the concept of this big movie being split into two films.
This time they were upfront about it.
Yeah.
So they've learned from the last time. So either way, is what I'm trying to say is. Donner, because we've all probably have seen the Richard Donner cut, which has been released recently. But like the whole point is, he did shoot most of the film. All Richard Lester did do was go in and like, you know, okay, do a scene here, do a scene here to try and. Okay, this wasn't finished. This wasn't done. But the Fortress of Solitude sequence in the end was done by Lester, wasn't it? Well, some of it. How about the whole shield and the laser beam mines and all that? The new powers in Superman, we're all sitting there going.
Yeah. Where the hell did that come from?
But that's all left. That's all from the Lester version. But the problem was Donner had shot about 75% of the movie.
Yeah.
Okay, which in terms of the Directors Guild Award would still mean he would actually get the
director. He still did the director.
He has to. Okay, not only did he have to go reshoot scenes that hadn't been shot, he had to reshoot and restage scenes that had already been shot. And I don't know. I mean, we love Superman 2. We all watch Superman 2. We loved it because it's a great, you know, it's much more on the nose, punching. But. And here's my big but. I think there are like too many beats in it every now and then, and every moment of tension, of genuine tension in the movie, is undercut by humor.
Yeah.
They have to throw in a gag. They have to throw in a gag. And I think.
Yeah, that, you think that was Donner?
Yeah. Well, no, that's not Donner at all. That's Lester. Lester is a great, great comedy director. I'm not going to take anything away from him that. But I just felt that, you know, put it this way, Superman 3. Is all Lester. Spot the difference between.
Well, that's why it's crap.
Yeah,
but
what we're saying is, how much humor is in there? How much humor is in there? You know. But once again, we're getting forward on ourselves. But get back to Superman 2. I think watching the Donner cut is a kind of what it could have. Not this is the finished version and this is the other version. This is a kind of like, you know, it's a bit like a work in progress.
It's very pale, to be honest with you, the Donner cut.
I mean, I love the Donner cut.
But I think it's like what you just said, that all Lester did was reframe some shots and add some stuff.
It wasn't cheaper at all. In fact, if anything, it's actually more. That at the time, by the time Superman 2 had been released in the US, which was in 81, you got it a few months later in 81. And it suffered as a result, box office wise as well, because in the US, it went up against Raiders that summer. Mm-hmm. But Kiss of Death. But anyway, I've lost my thread now. Cut a long story short.
Here's a question, then, Murph.
Okay, ask me.
Here's a question. So the general which against the outside, that was Lester, was it?
That's Lester. No, that's Donner.
So that's Donner. I thought Donner was the. Have you heard the Freedom of the Press or something? Was Donner or Lester?
Oh, sorry. Sorry. I thought you meant the actual the bar thing. Oh, so General, would you care to step outside? Yeah. That is Lester. I'll give him that. Yeah. Lester, there is some good stuff in there. But once again, the tone is a shifting tone. It's a much. Overall, there's a definite lighter tone, whereas the tone of the Donner cut is closer to the original movie. It feels more to me, anyway. It feels more like a part two.
Yeah.
As opposed to just the next movie, you know what I mean? You know.
What about Terence Stamp as General Zod? Again, tying into the Three Musketeers, Oliver Reed was supposed to have been caught and he wouldn't work with the Soul Kind. But then did Prince and the Pauper. You know, then again, he's probably sozzled when he.
He's up there with Khan.
Yeah,
he really is. It's just. He's just loving every minute of it.
He owned that role, and hence
when it was announced years later that, you know, Zod's going to be the villain in Man of Steel, your first thoughts are, and you do that classic fanboy thing, oh my God, how could any actor be as good as?
Yeah.
Which is a really, I frankly are quite a dumb attitude to have.
No.
It's been like 1,000 Hamlets, so.
But also, remember, like, Stan went on to do the voice of Zod in the Smallville series, so.
Yeah, the voice of Jor-El. He was Jor-El.
Oh yeah, well, okay,
so there's like a lineage there, isn't there?
But Callum Blue was on. Callum but seriously, I've got wooden tables that have more range. But there we go.
Okay, so
your big fold.
So anyway, what we know to be Superman 2 before the Donner cut, there seems to be the effects. There seems to be a little. The opening credits aren't quite the same as the first one. And
Ken Thorne, because of the re-editing and everything.
Well, yeah, but not just that though. I mean, the Ken Thorne, he had a smaller budget for his orchestra. John Williams was too busy. Yeah. He couldn't do it. He was working on Empire Strikes Back and Raiders at the same time. And
Heartbeats as well, apparently.
Okay.
Superman 2 could. Are you saying like?
Well, we can't leave it without talking about the fight.
Oh yeah, no, I was getting to that, but I'm just gonna say, if Superman the movie established, I think Superman 2 was the one that it seemed to be more influential. You know, when you get to that kind of, here's what happens, the character in conflict, and he's got to go through this. I mean, Spider-Man 2 followed like a similar kind of.
It's a hard one really, because I think the one thing we all learn from Superman 2 is like you say, is the fight. It's the fight. It's the Metropolis scene, and you know, and give or take a few gags that are in there.
The product placement
and the ridiculously. That's right up there with Boomerang for bad product placement.
Cool, cool.
It's just we all sat there and we was aghast at things like when he was swinging Zod round and he's doing all that sort of stuff.
Turned into the cartoon music. Something like that, when he's swinging down around and everybody coming up, image of that cop go,
One of the problems I've had with that for years is, where Ursa throws the sewer lid at him and he goes into the car, and the car does. I know he can't just stop himself, but you'd think the car of Superman crashed into
there were people in the car as well.
You're falling into a trap now with invoking logic. The moment we question any of it, the whole thing falls apart.
And then you'll wonder why all of a sudden the big bus is paper thin and something like that.
There's moments, there's some great, I love it when the rage in Zod's voice when he's going, throw it! Yeah. You know, and all that sort of stuff.
Or when he's angry and he's blowing like super breath. You know what I mean?
His accent slips and we hear the East End lad saying, take him! Cast him!
And all that. Okay, so we've talked about your how you responded to Superman the movie. What was your response to Superman 2 then?
Just absolutely loved it. Absolutely.
Yeah. Unfortunately, it doesn't sound like we loved it, but we did.
My friend Paul, though. My friend Paul Reese, was my best friend at the time. He didn't like it as much, and he actually, you remember him thinking he got a bit boring in bits, and then the fight happened, and he's all into that, whatever. But cut long story short, we loved it, absolutely loved it. I mean, I watched one and two when we first got a VCR. I watched one and two on rental on a loop. Mm. I literally would watch Superman 2, get to the end, press rewind. Press play again.
It's fantastic. It has that.
It's one of those Sunday movies that you can like either if it's on you'll watch the whole thing
you can't just like that's on. No, I'm gonna stay for a bit.
Yeah.
America then, Chase. You have to wait a little bit longer than what we did in England. So what was your?
I mean, you know, look forward to it. I mean, there's always the big posters and stuff of it coming out, and then the poster we had like the three Kryptonians flying towards the. Towards the screen and stuff like that, so it's definitely something like this. When we're waiting for the BBS, it's like something that we knew was coming, and it didn't disappoint because of the fighting. Because Superman the movie didn't have any fighting, you know, we knew that we were going to be fighting this. We knew they were from Krypton, and they were, you know, going to be superpowered, you know. But only in looking back, you're a bit disappointed that it wasn't like Man of Steel, that's later, but that it wasn't like the big bombastic fight.
Right.
You know, it was pretty paper thin. Everything was like made of paper and tissue in a way. You know, like he would hit things, they would bend. You know, like go into a building, wouldn't go through it, you know.
There's a great gag in the rubber most girder. People don't pick up on, which Donner shot. Because Donner shot, he shot a lot of inserts. For the fight, he didn't actually shoot the fight itself. Yep. A lot of instances. There's a great gag in it, actually, as in what I mean, gags and trick, stunt, whatever effect, whatever you want to call it, which echoes the same gag in the first movie with the cat burglar. And there's a scene where Zod gets punched.
Going down.
Zod gets punched. Not Zod, sorry, Non gets punched, and he flies through a building, and he goes through an office space, and everyone's going like that. And what people don't realize is the whole office was actually upside down, and people were bumped in, and they dropped the stuntman, just dropped him through the floors.
Wow.
But of course, they flipped it, and of course, it looks like he's going.
There's
one guy in particular who's kind of done this weird, bizarre movement. You know, this is what you get when you see a movie 1,000 times, you can start to spot these little things. You know, and it's little things like that. In the first movie, where you got the guy at the office desk when you got Superman behind him, what's standing on the window, and he was bolted in to his desk like that. And he was like, what was that? You know.
Yeah.
But he's clearly like that. You know.
Yeah,
but that's a great one.
Donna or Lester?
That was Donna who did that one. Yeah. He did a lot of inserts and whatnot. But you know, I mean, it was a hit. It wasn't as big a hit as the first. I mean, he got hurt in America, but it was.
It was
a bigger hit worldwide than it was in the US.
Yeah, I still think it
wasn't a flop.
I still think you have to consider it a hit because you know we're gonna start to go downhill. So I think you still have to consider it.
Yeah. But you got to remember though, there was globally movie attendances within the short space of time began to wane for whatever reason, and by the time Superman 2 comes out, it's like the third or fourth big hit of that year, not the first or the second.
Yeah.
You know, you've got, like in the States, it got beaten by movies like On Golden Pond, they bore money. Then Superman 2.
Well, that's what people used to like,
you know,
to
but,
watch regular
but,
drama.
You know, it made a little bit more than, say, Fury Eyes Only that year.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it made the top five of that
year.
Well,
let me just say, because we do have to move on, let me just say that, like, this Superman 2 was the actual quintessential comic book movie of its time because of the battle, because of we're talking about the 80s, right?
Yeah.
But it was like, you know, we're talking about on TV, we barely got, you know, Hulk and Spider-Man and all that other kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So this was when we could see a superhero film on a big screen. So it was successful, definitely.
Brilliant. And can I just ask a question before we move on to Superman? You might know the answer to this better than me. Well, I don't know the answer to this. You know the line, don't do it, the people?
Mm-hmm.
Don't do it, the people!
He seems to be smiling there.
I think that would have been one of several takes they would have taken, and I think that's a poor take that they chose.
I also think it's an overdub as well. I don't think that's
probably
quite that take.
Probably.
Okay then, well, now we move on. 1989. Summer of the Bat. Batman, Tim Burton's Batman film again.
Mm.
Gents, I'll start chasing yourself. What was your...
Yeah, so I was a messenger at the time and everything like that. And I actually remember getting the book. What was it? Sam Hamm, you know, talking about Danny O'Neill's Batman and Bill Finger and who was... And they brought all of that stuff out because of the marketing had begun. This is the beginning of, not the internet, but the beginning of marketing, like, in that aspect. So we got all the bat symbols, and, you know, you're looking around, you're seeing it. And I'm in New York City, so it's everywhere.
Oh, yeah,
and everything,
weird.
You know, yeah. I mean, you know, everywhere you go, there's the bat symbol and all that. So, now, you can't talk about that launch without talking about, why the hell is it Michael Keaton?
Yeah, I was just about to ask that.
Okay. I mean, I'm just saying. Batman, oh, this looks good. It's like the same thing with the Superman philosophy. Let's get a big actor to be the villain. So we got Jack Nicholson. But why the hell is it Michael Keaton?
So what was your reaction when you found out?
Well, that's what everyone... Well, my first reaction, before you start thinking about it, is surprise.
Yeah.
It's just... Okay. Before you start thinking, why the hell is that? You're like, really? Really? Before you even examine it, good, bad, or indifferent, you're like, really? Really?
Yeah.
Really? At the time, so what? The casting was announced in 88. And around about that time, in 88, I actually first started my first stand-up gigs. And Michael Keaton, as a comedian, I was a humongous fan of. Okay, you know, Beetlejuice was on the horizon, but I'd loved him I fell in love with him as a comedian from Night Shift.
His first movie.
And I subsequently had seen some of his stand-up footage and blah, blah, blah. And his other movies, which had been a bit hit and miss.
Mr. Mom,
which I like, but you know.
Clean and Sober was
Clean and Sober was
that
great.
That was the change, though.
But
yeah,
we didn't get
Clean
and
Sober
in the UK until after Batman. They actually held it off. They held
it off.
It
came
out
before Batman.
Okay. In the US, it came out before. We got it after. Because, to cut a long story short, I just thought, the moment I realised, okay, it's Michael Keaton, I have no idea where this movie's going. Which means they're not going down the traditional or predictable route.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, those who knew Tim Burton by that time, really, the moment we knew he was attached to it, I wasn't expecting Superman with a mask on.
Yeah.
You know, in terms of actually the movie itself, I knew it would be different. It wouldn't necessarily be something that I would be like, because you know, your first thoughts are,
if it's going to be like Batman, it's going to be like the comics. It's going to be
like that. But at the same time, you think, okay, interesting choice. They're doing something different with it. Me personally, I'm thinking, right, okay, I respect that. Well, let's see where this goes. Okay, of course, the world, you know.
Yeah.
I can't imagine. I mean, it's funny because people complain about Affleck getting cast as Batman. That was nothing
compared to my
nothing. Figure. And this is the days before the internet as well.
Didn't Variety take like an advertisement?
But I think it invented the internet because I think it was so much complaint that people needed somewhere to complain.
It's interesting because the Wall Street Journal had predicted that it may affect just the casting announcement would affect Warner Brothers' stock value. But you know, as somebody else pointed out, just because a guy writes 10 letters doesn't necessarily mean he's representing 10 people. You know,
I think as well, Keaton's casting, if you look, it's kind of a shift to like the more anti-hero kind of thing. So you get Peter Weller as Robocop.
Yeah.
Yeah, like someone like Jeff Goldblum in The Fly and stuff, and Michael Keaton kind of that casting.
They've gone for quirk.
But I think he's absolutely terrific.
So anyway, so now Keaton got this big receding hairline, that was another thing. Mm-hmm. But also he had the success of Beetlejuice. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So like what happened was is that he did Clean and Sober just to kind of prove that, look, I could do drama, man. I mean, I could do drama and I could do something deep and dark, which is what The Dark Knight was. He brought it. He brought the brood to Bruce Wayne. Michael Keaton brought the brood to Bruce Wayne.
You said The Dark Knight, that's why I thought you meant like...
No, I didn't. No,
you know, squeezing.
Batman is called The Dark Knight. Yeah. So he brought the brood to Bruce Wayne. So, like, in that aspect is that there was this one scene that seemed out of character, but it was, like, I guess, integral to the Michael Keaton casting was, like, and I can't remember exactly when it happened, but he was as Bruce Wayne, and I think he was confronting Joker at the museum.
Yeah.
You know, and he's like, come on, you want to get crazy? Let's get crazy! You know what I mean? And it's like, it's Beetlejuice.
There's an intensity in there.
I was trying to say, it was a little bit much. It was very Beetlejuice.
A lot of his performances are a bit like he's like a shook up bottle.
Mm.
Okay, and he's desperately trying to keep the hey, you know, that kind of thing, you know, and every now and then and that's an example of the lid comes off for a few moments and back on. I got plenty of complaints about the movie. It's far from perfect. It's very enjoyable. It's not a Batman movie by any stretch of the imagination. It's a very entertaining movie, but to me it's not a Batman movie. And I felt like I really like this movie. It's cool. I like the car. I love the music. Blah blah blah. Prince. Huge Prince fan, but you know, as soon as I found that he was attached to the movie, I thought, But I just felt that it's kind of the balance was kind of like, and also fundamentally, Batman stroke Bruce Wayne didn't have an awful lot to do.
Well, I got the impression from that film.
Well, that's why I say Bruce Wayne was just the broody kid in the cave.
That's what I'm saying.
Had something much more to do, you know.
To me,
Vicki Vale was supposed to be something, but there was no chemistry between the two of them. Mm-hmm. Basinger, there was no real chemistry in that, and that was supposed to be something.
I think that's a good point. I think the fact that I get the impression that Michael Keaton has Bruce Wayne. Bruce Wayne is the disguise, I think. Do you know what I mean? Batman is the real him.
But when he was Bruce Wayne, he never really did anything, is what I think we're saying.
It's the same sort of like discussion about with Clark Kent as well. Who is the real person?
Yeah.
What is the real disguise? I think they're both, as in Batman and Bruce Wayne. I think they are definitely both. I think they just bring out the different. They are dual personality, and I think if we could get the two together, they'd make a great person.
Yeah.
Mm. But unfortunately, we have to.
I tell you, the influence of that film, though, still felt. For years, like most superhero
it's
in its
great
way
legacy,
looked
yeah.
like it, and the Danny Elfman music was
Danny
like,
Elfman music. If
yeah,
without
amazing.
That was primarily without that movie and the one that followed it, we wouldn't have DC's animation. Bruce Timm and
Eric Burnett's
Batman the Animated Series and the subsequent shows that followed from
that
stem originally. But going back to the actual movie itself, I think one thing that's really played down, we always hear about, Frank Miller's Dark Knight. Yes, what that did do is it gave the overall influence of taking this role, taking this seriously.
Yeah.
Okay, taking this seriously. Not serious as in po-face, but take it, this is not Adam West. Well, it could be argued that the bigger influence on the actual film itself would be Alan Moore's Killing Joke.
Yeah,
yeah, but that came out after the film.
It didn't come out maybe yet.
In fact,
Tim Burton would take copies of it to production meetings, early production meetings, and go, "This is how I want the movie to look." I don't know. One thing that's interesting is, I'm not sure how aware of it you were at the time because we're old. but the is without a doubt, at least in my experience, the single most hyped movie.
Oh yeah, I can remember.
Ever. But the problem is, and I can totally understand why Tim Burton was reluctant to come back and do another one, was the fact that it was felt like it was a Batman festival. Oh, and in the middle of it all, there's a movie.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's kind of like, seriously. Yeah, I like Superman the movie. I was in America when it came out. I was there. It came out. I can tell you, it came out on June 23rd, and I was in the States on June 26th. And I was there. We got the flight. We ended up in Miami, and I saw it. The night of the day we got there. I'm gonna wait. So I was there right in the middle of that hype and madness or whatever. And like I said, Chase, you remember this, you just simply could not go anywhere.
Without
anywhere at all. And it's just ridiculous. It was like Star Wars times 10.
And the thing about it was the movie was about Batman. It wasn't about Bruce Wayne. It wasn't about Michael Keaton. It was that. It was the iconography, and that's what it did. It served its purpose to change or to wipe away the existence of the Adam West, right? And we wouldn't have the Dark Knight or anything like you said about
exactly,
series
without that movie. Yeah.
I mean, and one of the master pieces in that was you have a dance with the devil in the pale moonlight.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Okay, let's talk about Jack.
That, I mean,
talk about Jack then. Jack, he was phenomenal in the film, I think.
I love this because he's not. Jack Nicholson, he's just been told to go and do your Richard Pryor thing.
Yeah.
And he works best when he's actually got solid material. And unfortunately, though, that's just not the movie to put him in. It's just simply not the movie to put him in. You hear about all the other ideas that they had. Even Sulkin, for all his faults, he had some good ideas for Superman 3, much closer to comic books. Your Brainiac was going to be at one point.
Obviously, the whole robot thing.
Then there's the Richard Donner idea, which was a good idea. Sorry, take it.
Obviously, the whole robot thing was supposed to be Brainiac, but then Sulkin must have got some computer game money and said, hey, if it's a computer game, let's. Yeah, make it a computer
and
game.
Of course, there's the other idea that Richard Donner was going to have because he and Tom Mankiewicz had an idea that they would actually take over the production of Superman movies and they were going to produce one every other year.
Like Bond,
exactly. And they had an idea to do 7 movies, so that they only got the idea in the planning stages of they had an idea for a third movie, which subsequently in 2008 or maybe later, I can't remember exactly the date. DC produced the Last Sun graphic novel, which was based on Dick Donner's idea, which was this child who comes to a child from Krypton who lands, and the government want to take him away. And essentially, it's Superman versus the government, which Donner was. He actually wasn't going to. He wasn't going to direct it. Tom Mankiewicz was going to direct.
That's right.
He was going to produce it. But of course, spoiler alert, folks. Okay, it turns out that he's actually the son of Zod. And Zod returns, and there's all another big fight.
Which is like the Vile Zod, Black Superman, in Earth 2 from the comic books.
You find these things out later, and you think, oh man, that's such a cool idea. But no, they went down the city because Richard Lester had his head on this one. This is much more than the rest of this competition.
Anyway.
Okay, if we move on to back to Batman, if we sort of combine. What we discussed from Batman Forever and Robin into one thing.
Batman Returns.
Oh, good lord, we haven't. Back a bit. Batman Returns.
Batman Returns, 1992. The parents hated.
I loved it.
Yeah, exactly, which is what I didn't want to talk about. Yeah, so Batman versus the Penguin and Michelle Pfeiffer's seminal performance as Catwoman.
Stylistically. I absolutely loved it, but not as a Batman movie, as a Tim Burton movie. I think it's one of Tim Burton's best looking movies he's ever done by far.
Batman what's it as Max Shrek.
But as a Batman movie, it's not a Batman movie at all by any stretch of imagination. It's a pantomime. But without the horribleness of what came later. It's an exercise in style.
Yeah,
and it's style over content,
the greatest comic book villain of all time is the Penguin. I love him, and I didn't really like what I know. It's a Tim Burton film, but it's filtered that way. But I didn't like what I was seeing.
It was a terrible iteration of Penguin. His mythos, his origins. It was horrible. It was completely horrible. Yeah. I mean, it was so Tim Burton. It was so off kilter that somebody just let him go and just go do it. I mean, it was like begging him to come back, and then
the only reason he agreed to do it, apart from obviously the truckload of money, but the fact that they gave him his head on it, he said, "Listen, you know, please do it. You directed the first one. You made this ridiculous amount of money. It's the biggest Warner Brothers movie of all time. Blah 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 blah. Please come back." And he said, "I will do it, but here are my conditions." And he had much stronger conditions. That first and foremost, we're going to have none of that kind of Batman festival business that happened before. It's just going to be the movie. Da, 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 da. I'm going to have, you know, much more control over the production itself.
John Peters the producer?
John Peters the producer, but...
there you go. There it explains it all.
John Peters and Peter Gruber as well. There was
totally, two hairdressers producing the film. Totally explains it all.
One hairdresser, one music producer.
John Peters was, of course, he did the Barbra Streisand boxing movie.
He's also the man behind that whole Superman Lives Fiasco,
Batman Returns itself. If anything, it at least gives me one of my favourite Danny Elfman scores.
Oh yeah, it's fantastic.
It's only a few beats behind my favourite Danny Elfman score, which is Edward Scissorhands. But it's like I say, it's lovely to look at. Absolutely love. Michael Keaton's got nothing to do in the movie whatsoever.
Yeah,
nothing.
You're just kind of like, yeah, I got my paycheck over there, right? So okay, I just sit here and I brood.
I tell you, I do love that scene at the beginning though, where what are you waiting for? The signal. And then it cuts to him, and it's like he's literally waiting for something to happen. So
he's like that.
Yeah, and that he's sort of just. This is it. It's like you can't like switch.
I look somber. Look somberer.
So your reaction when you seen it in 1992?
I was scared, terrified, and mortified. I was all those things all at once. I mean, the penguin eating fish. It was just kind of like horrible. I can't even look at that movie. I mean, despite the fact that people say how great Michelle Pfeiffer was, I still thought that was terrible. I mean, when she was pushed out the window and she's like looking like she's about to be eaten by cats.
Yeah.
Those cats look like rats to me. And it was horrible. I totally do not get the perspective of this movie or what the hell was in Tim Burton's punch.
It's really, really nice to look at. I remember my then girlfriend who I saw it with on opening night. She was beside herself because she loved all things cats. So the cat iconography throughout the entire film, she was like in heaven over it. She's like, oh, that's the greatest movie ever made. Blah, 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 blah. But when you actually examine it, it does win plus points though, because there's a fantastic orchestrated version of Super Freak playing the party at the end.
Yeah.
But I love Face to Face by Susie the Banshee. I think that's a really good.
Between Penguin and anybody, you know what I mean? Penguin's the big villain, right?
He's not, that's the whole point. He's not.
He's tortured?
No, Chris Walken's the villain, the actual piece.
He's manipulated.
He's manipulated the Penguin just as much as anybody else. But, you know, and I think, I don't know. It bugged me at the time, because I wish that they pushed Christopher Walken's name up there with everybody else's. You have the three main stars.
Yeah, but he probably saw the movie. He'd say, let me just hide.
Would it be terribly sexist of me to say that Michelle Pfeiffer's behind in it is quite breathtaking?
Her whole body is quite breathtaking in that. That's the whole point. Yeah, anyway.
Okay. But it's interesting, but would you have felt the same had it been Annette Bening?
I don't know. I'd have to see that.
Because if we're talking about women we find kind of a little bit nice, then I think the difference between the two of them had it have been Annette Bening who had to pull out because she's pregnant, was the fact that I think that she is a much more, as an actress wise, much more earthy actress, and so the vampiness, the sexiness, I think would have definitely come out.
Yep.
What's good about Michelle Pfeiffer's characterization? There is an innocence still in the naivety of the character. You know, but
what about Sean Young? Do you think?
Yeah, well, only because she did Blade Runner.
Well, yeah, but she was
crazy.
She was Vicky Vale as well.
She was also Test Two Artist.
And she was crazy
from that.
No, she wasn't. She broke a collarbone. She couldn't. She was days away from filming her first scenes for the first Batman movie. It's Vicky Vale.
Yep.
She fell off the horse for a scene that ended up getting cut anyway.
Yep. But she was the original Test Two Artist and Dick Tracy, but she had no chemistry with Charlie Goldsman playing.
Unfortunately, her off-screen behaviour damaged her career.
Yeah,
so she was blacklisted for a long time. Really,
yeah.
You know, bloody fool. But there we go.
Okay, then. Well, we've reached the point that you're waiting for.
Because I mean, like, the camera cut off twice.
Okay. So are we going to finish up here, James?
Well, I think we should end on a cliffhanger.
Okay, going on
Okay,
guys, well, we'll see you after the
movie. Hold on, okay, yeah, we're still going, so.
Okay, alright, but it gives us time then, very quick. Okay.
Oh, well, to end it.
Okay.
We have a major cliffhanger, though.
Okay.
What's a cliffhanger?
The cliffhanger
is it's the next movie we're talking about.
Yes.
What
is that?
Well, in 1986, the Cannon Group bought the rights to Superman movie franchise from the Salkinds, and they went on to make what is considered by many to be one of the worst superhero films, but films of all time, Superman 4, The Quest for Peace. And when we return after you've seen Batman vs. Superman, we can cover that then. I think that sounds about.
Until then, up.
And away. Same bat time, same bat channel.
Indeed.
Farewell.
Pretty sure you can believe a man can fly.